Welcome back to Punoy Crossover. My question, where were you when that deal happened? And you know, not deal, deals.
Deals.
A bunch of deals. So give us the down low, traded for whom, where did this, this is a lot of things happen.
Trade deadline, man.
Oh my God.
Well, there's a lot of trades that happen, but let's just focus on the ones that are really important because this is, you know, this changes a lot of the dynamics that's happening in the East and the competition and who's really the best team in the East. So let's go straight up to all the things that Cavs did really to revamp their whole roster. Let's start with the first, you know, let's start with a little bit of the cheesy ones. Like we got, you know, the first one was Rose and Crowder going to Utah. And then we got Shumpert going to Sacramento. We got Wade going back to Miami.
that's pretty funny.
And we got Isaiah and Fry going to the Lakers. So these are all the players that they've lost. Yeah. And these are the players that they've acquired through all these, you know, through all basically revamping the roster. You got Clarkson and Larry Nance Jr. coming from the Lakers to the Cavs. And then you got George Hill coming from Sacramento to the Cavs. And then you got Rodney Hood coming from Utah going to the Cavs. What are you guys' thoughts so far? What does this new revamp roster look like? What do you think about this so far?
I think they're shipping out the old man's.
Getting the young and old and the slow.
With that point, that's not, that's a good assessment of what happened because the Cleveland Cavaliers, with the main roster that they used to have, well, they're old.
They're old.
That is actually what their rookie GM said, Coleman, saying they wanted to get faster, they wanted to get a bit more athletic because if you watch them play, they're slow, they're a bit step behind on defense, and they just don't have the energy that that you get from like a team that are young, like the Sixers or the Lakers. So that's what they're able to do.
I think, who do I like from the trade? Larry Nance.
His poster.
Jordan Clarkson, shout out to him. Filipino. Hey, it's a Pinoy crossover.
Like, shout out to
Jordan Clarkson. What's up, man? Let's come back to my boy Cup. Take a picture with us.
But yeah, for the Cleveland Cavaliers, it kind of looks like a rebuild, but they're still in that number three seed in the playoff spot. So they still have a chance to actually make a strong playoff run to the Eastern Conference Finals, and obviously hoping for another NBA Finals run with the squad that they have on paper. Obviously, on paper, it kind of looks good, but we still have to see. This is halfway through the season. Well, more than halfway through the season. Chemistry is very, very important in the NBA, on any NBA team. So we'll have to see what happens with the chemistry because there's no training camp. The only training camp they'll only have will be All-Star break. They don't know how many days will that be and how long this chemistry will work out. What happens if this chemistry would blow out and then they'll be back where they started in January when they started, you know, pointing fingers at each other.
That's true. There's all locker room talk. Does this trade do anything about beating Golden State? Does this have anything to do, or do they even have a chance with Golden State now rebuilding so far into the season?
Yeah, that's really hard to tell. But one thing I can say is that they needed a culture change too, because what this really do is you put together all the players that, if you really look at it, didn't really get along with LeBron James. IT was a very ball-dominant player. He needed the ball in his hand to be able to score. He knew that what he was. He was a ball-dominant scorer. Mm-hmm. And in Cleveland, it's LeBron's basketball, right? It's as much as you want to, you know, you want to play how the way you want to play, the way you feel like you're effective. You can't really go against the best player in the league, right? In a sense, and think about it. And I feel like,
plus he didn't make his shots. Plus
he was efficient. He was a defensive liability. And I feel like this also has the culture in Boston. These two guys like Jay Crowder and Isaiah were a Boston player, and they had rivalry with the Cavs, and it felt like it wasn't a match for them because their mindset was different. The way they were, you know, they were accustomed to the culture in Boston was different when they went to the Cavs because technically they were against each other, right? It just didn't work out. And I felt like a couple of their moves also as well was just to get rid of, you know, people with egos. And I think, I think IT and Rose were some of the players that really had egos. And they also weighed not much of ego, but more of like his relationship with LeBron, so it was really hard for them to see that, you know, Wade is basically at the decline of his career, and it's not really working out in terms of He's mm-hmm. not the kind of player that really to surround LeBron James with, and they needed players that can space out the floor and play two-way basketball, and that is what they're getting from a guy like George Hill, and you're going to get that from Rodney Hood because mm-hmm. it's going to space for them. And I think Rodney Hood is a better version of J.R. Smith, so I think this is an improvement for them. And then you gotta you have a guy like Jordan Clarkson, which is like Isaiah Thomas, kind of like the way he plays,
but bigger,
but he's bigger, tall, and he can defend
stronger.
Exactly. And you stronger. And you're getting players that like I mentioned before had no egos and mm-hmm. are like perfect role players for how LeBron James to surround LeBron James, in the sense of mm-hmm. LeBron James need players that don't have egos and can play without the basketball all in their hands, and that's what they're getting with Larry Nance, who's a very good player, actually role player. So if you actually watch him, and you're gonna get a guy like Hood who can just make shots and can score off, you know, off screens, which is and Clarkson. Yeah. These are two players that
and Hill too.
And Hill is just a shooter. He's a perfect point guard for LeBron, because when you watch him play, when he was great at San Antonio, he wasn't the main, you know, he wasn't the main ball handler for them. It was, you know, Kawhi at points, Manu, and that was perfect for George Hill because he was a good spot up shooter for them, and he was a good defender, mm-hmm. and that's what he's going to bring to them if he still got his legs. That's one thing that we still have to figure out, because Hill's been injury prone and mm-hmm. he's basically at, you know, decline of his career too.
For the Cavs, it's another situation of they're actually still building for a future. They mm-hmm. have a future. They did have a future with like having Jay Crowder, Green, and mm-hmm. Isaiah Thomas, and then they also have a future again. But with what's key in this is that they still have the Brooklyn first pick,
exactly
a first round pick, which is key in this. So whether LeBron leaves or not, they have a good draft. They have a draft pick. They can use the Brooklyn draft pick, which mm-hmm. they could draft a really good player, or draft the player, send them elsewhere, and get another bunch of players again. Mm-hmm. But we'll have to see what happens if LeBron will leave or not. Because that's another situation if he will like to stick with the Cavs, which, you know, obviously he's been saying he wants to stick with the Cavs. He doesn't want to leave. But
burn the jersey twice.
I think he'll tarnish his legacy a little bit just because he left Cleveland twice.
Yeah.
But if he wants to chase Jordan, Michael Jordan, in rings, moving elsewhere wouldn't be a bad idea.
Lakers.
If you want to chase for rings, Lakers. Yeah. Speaking of the Lakers, with the trades with Jordan Clarkson and Larry Nance Jr. moving away, they have space for two max contracts signing in the next few years, whether it be if they chase for Paul George or even LeBron James. But for me, I want LeBron James on the San Antonio Spurs.
Basically, to summarize the whole trade that Cleveland Cavaliers did, they said they're basically saying that we're gonna go for it. We're gonna try to, you know, improve the team, make the most of what LeBron James have, you know, what, you know, which is basically till the end of this season, and then he can make up his mind whatever he wants to do after that, because the fact that they were still able to keep their first pick, so basically mm-hmm. they're going to build with or without LeBron James, but they're going to make the most of his time here, and even if he leaves, they still have players to build around because of the fact that Larry Nance, you know, Clarkson, Rodney Hood, they're still inked for a couple more years.
All on contracts, exactly. For sure.
All right, and hey, on contract, hey, show's end. Show's ending.
We gotta end.
The time's up. Anything you'd like to say before we end the show?
Don't forget to follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. @Pinor Costa. We've got a lot of content over there. Check us out.
Marky Mark, anything you'd like to say?
Well, keep watching the Cavs to see if they get better.
Yeah, man.
Shout out to, you know, Matthew Wright, PBA man. Happy birthday to
Happy
you.
Happy birthday, man.
If you have anything you'd like to shout out, make sure you comment on our social media. I know female baller Arij, I think, signed to a high school recently, so shout out to you. Mm-hmm. But
you give a shout out to our fellow person that came to. That just broke the score for Humber.
Oh yeah, right? CJ Fuente, Miss CJ Humber legend now.
Yeah.
Women's Humber legend. But yeah, thank you guys for watching. Stay tuned and stay ballin'.